Welcome, everybody, to Algebra 2, Section 4B.6, our final section with all this work in Chapter 4 on working with polynomials. It sure has been a big endeavor and truly one of the defining aspects of Algebra 2 in general. This is a good gateway for future math classes you may be taking. I know pre-calculus spends a lot of time working with polynomials as well, so hopefully we've taken a lot. I know there certainly has been a lot of information here, but hopefully we feel like we're walking away with a lot of understanding with what's going on here. Now, the final lesson here, this 4.6 or 4b.6, it's all about how we can take all this knowledge, and it's a perfect concluding section. All of this knowledge that we've taken about polynomials, how can we use these new types of functions to help us in the real world? And we've talked about before taking a data set and looking at a best fit line. That works really well, but sometimes our data points don't follow a best fit line. And we saw quadratics, another type of polynomial in Chapter 3 when we modeled quadratic equations, real-world situations with quadratics. So now we're going to take a look at higher degrees as well. This just really ties the math that we're learning in with the real world and kind of how we can use functions to help us explain what's happening in the world around us. It's an amazing way to end a chapter. So let's get to it. All right, so first we're going to be looking at a data set, and often that is going to be a table of values that we're looking at. When the x values of data are equally spaced, the differences in y values are called finite differences. So you probably remember learning freshman year that a linear function is defined by having a constant rate of change. That is the first difference in the y column. The difference from one y to the next remains constant. And we saw in Chapter 3 that with quadratics, it's not the first set of differences, but then we take the difference of that. So we called it the second difference. And we can continue that onward and do the third difference and fourth difference. Whenever we find the level of difference where the difference remains constant, that tells us the degree of the function that we're working with. All right, so that's what this next bullet point actually says. If the nth differences of equally spaced data are non-zero and constant, then the data can be represented by an nth degree polynomial function. That's great information, but how do we actually get to that best fit function? Well, we're going to enter the data in the stat menu just like we did before. And depending on whether or not we have finite differences, we may look at a graph of those functions. And so this is if not equally spaced. We can actually look at, have the calculator plot the points for us. So we can see, are we seeing like bending that indicates a cubic type function? Are we seeing the ends rise with more bending happening in the middle like a fourth degree polynomial would have? But those data points, depending on what kind of pattern they're showing, could give us a better look here. And we'll talk a little bit more about how we can tell what the best fit function is later on. So based on the arrangement of the points, we will decide on either quadratic regression, which is what we did in Chapter 3, cubic regression, which is something new, that's a higher degree polynomial, or quartic regression to find a function of best fit. Okay, so based on the arrangement of the points or a finite difference, if that's available, those are our options. So it's a lot of exploring data, which is really, really good. The algebraic work here is actually somewhat minimal. So our first example is, I believe, the only by hand example that we have. So if you take a look, write a function in factored form whose graph is shown here. And if you remember working with vertex form of a quadratic back in Chapter 3, when we had that vertex form, all of our effort algebra-wise was solving for the a value. That's exactly what's happening here. This should actually say, here, I think I mistyped my factors, so I apologize for that. It should be x minus b, x minus c, x minus d. So that should be a c, and this should be a d, whose graph is shown. So if you know, based on what we've done in the previous sections, all these factors are taking the zeros out of the graph. So we've got three real zeros. They're negative 6, negative 3, and positive 3. So my function is going to be y equals some a value times x minus a negative 6 times x minus a negative 3 times x minus a positive 3. But you'll also notice that we really don't have enough information here. We've got three unknowns in this equation. And in order to actually answer the question of what is A, how is this graph being stretched or shrunk, we need another point. So that's what this y-intercept, this 0, negative 9, is showing us. That point 0, negative 9 is just some point that's not a 0 where our graph passes through. So it's giving us an input and an output on that curve that's not a 0. So I can substitute the y value of negative 9, the x value of 0, into those places for inputs and outputs. So negative 9 equals a times 6 times 3 times negative 3. Negative 9 equals a times, that's going to be a negative 6 times 3 is 18, 54. We'll divide away the negative 54. And remember, this is where all of our work is. And 9 over 54 simplifies to a positive 1 over 6. That's our a value. So the final function, we need a function that has inputs and outputs for our final answer. All of that work to find the a value gives us the final answer of y equals 1/6 x plus 6 times x plus 3 times x minus 3. All right, we may just want to quickly double check there. Does this positive 1/6 make sense? And we can look at the end behavior. Yeah, it's falling to the left, rising to the right. So we knew a had to be a positive to make this cubic function have the correct end behavior. And it has all the zeros contained that we wanted to see as well. So it makes sense graphically. All right, next, let's look at finite differences to determine the degree of the polynomial. Then use technology to actually find the polynomial. You can see our x values are equally spaced. They're counting up by 1 each time. That's crucial. If we don't have a pattern with x, we can't really hope to get anything out of a pattern we see in y. And so I like to show this with an arrow to say that I'm taking negative 5 minus negative 14. Negative 2 minus negative 5. 7 minus negative 2. 34 minus 7, which would be 27, and 91 minus 34, which would be 57. All right, so clearly the first set of differences did not come out equal, so that just tells us it's not linear. It's not a first degree polynomial that this data set is giving us. So let's look at the second set of differences. 3 minus 9, 9 minus 3, 27 minus 9, and 57 minus 27. Okay, these values again did not match, so it's not a second degree, it's not a quadratic. Let's check our third set of differences. 6 minus negative 6, 18 minus 6, and 30 minus 18. Take a look at that. Those differences came out equal, so that tells me that this is a cubic function that those points are representing. And so now we're going to just use technology. We were able to use finite differences to tell what type of regression to use. So I'm going to pull up my calculator here and we'll take a look. The nice thing about regression is the procedure really hasn't changed throughout any of the chapters that we've used this. So chapter 1, chapter 3, it's still the same. We're going to hit the stat key, which is right here. And I'm going to hit enter to edit the stats. If there was anything entered in list 1 or list 2, I would clear those out or type over them. And in the first list, I'm just going to list out my x values. So negative 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Just hitting enter after each one to lock them in. And the calculator is saving them as we go along, so that's really nice to know. Negative 14, let's enter the matching y values. Negative 5, negative 2, 7, 14, nope, 34, sorry, and 91. All right, and since we already know what type of regression we're going to use, we're going to be using a cubic regression. We found that out with our finite differences right over there. I'm going to hit the stat key again. It has saved all those values. I'm going to hit the right arrow key over here to calculate, And I'm going to go down to option 6. I know it's a cubic function, so we'll use cubic regression. And we'll hit enter. Here it's giving me some options. It's telling me for my x's, choose list 1. My y values, choose list 2. Frequency list, we don't care about that. Store the regression equation, we don't care about that. So I'm going to go hit the down arrow key each time until I get to calculate. And I will hit enter. And there it tells me what the values of A, B, C, and D, the coefficients on each of those terms and the constant at the end. Now another nice little benefit to have would be, it's called diagnostic or stat diagnostics. It would be really nice to have like an R value put out to tell how accurate this best fit line is. So I'm gonna go ahead and activate that really quickly. It just tells me if I made the right choice. It's some reassurance here. So because we had finite differences though, everything came out nice and clean for this example. So I'm gonna hit the mode key, right here next to second. Okay, and if we scroll down on this list, there's an option for stat diagnostics. I'm gonna turn that on. And then I'm gonna hit second quit. And I'm just gonna run my calculation again. So calculate, cubic regression, hit down arrow key just to calculate that one more time. And you can see the R value, or the R squared value it uses for higher degrees, is 1. That's like a perfect match. So this is a perfect cubic function. All right, so to go back and edit this now, or to put down our final answer, I guess, the function that we came up with is y equals 2x to the third minus 3x to the second plus 4x minus 5. And one small detail, if you're interested in statistics, whenever you make a function based off of regression information, the proper terminology is to call this y hat, so it has a little like caret symbol above it. That's not something that's necessary in this class, but it is a neat little thing to know about when you use regression. We don't just treat it like a y and x direct relationship. This just kind of shows that it came from data points. It might not be perfect. Alrighty. Let's take a look at the next one. Oh boy. So this one here, you can see number 12, we just have a list of points, which is unfortunate because it's such a really long, drawn out process. Let's just take a look at all of the x values along the way. It's so much more difficult to read than a nice table would be. So our x values go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. They're equally spaced. So let's use finite differences, and we're actually told to do that. So I'm actually going to take the time to write out a table just so I can show the arrows again. So my x's go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I hope I gave myself enough room. The y values are 0, 6, 2. 6, 12, negative 10, negative 114, definitely didn't leave enough room at the end, negative 378, and that's where I needed it most, negative 904. I'm going to go ahead and clean that up. Match up these x values a little bit better. Kind of hard to do that on a tablet. I'm guessing you could probably do a much better job just with lined notebook paper. All right, so first difference, 6 minus 0 is 6, 2 minus 6 is negative 4, 6 minus 2 is positive 4, 12 minus 6 is 6, negative 10 minus 12, negative 22, negative 114 minus a negative 10 is negative 104, negative 378 minus negative 114 is negative 264, and negative 904 minus negative 378. I'm just going to type that one up really quickly. 526. All right, so not linear. First difference didn't work. I'm not terribly surprised. Next set of differences. Negative 4 minus 6 is negative 10. 4 minus negative 4, positive 8. 6 minus 4 is 2. Sorry, these little arrows aren't showing up. Negative 22 minus 6 is negative 28. Negative 104 minus negative 22, that's negative 82. negative 264 minus negative 104 is negative 160. 526 minus 260 minus a negative 264. Oops, I left a negative off of that 526. I was going to say that was going to grow pretty rapidly. It's 262. One of the nice things about this, you can see that it's definitely something that you can easily lose or make a miscalculation along the way. But the nice thing is, as long as you're not screwing up all of the calculations, you'll probably see what line should have worked. Like maybe I'd see a lot of eights or something, but there's one like negative 17 in there or something. That usually shows you that, hey, maybe you made a little subtraction mistake somewhere in here. But just try and give it a little bit of care. 8 minus negative 10, 18. 2 minus 8, negative 6. Negative 28 minus 2 is negative 30. Negative 82 minus negative 28, that's negative 54. Negative 160 minus negative 82, ooh, what would that be? That would be negative 78. And 262, sorry, that should have been negative as well, negative 262 minus negative 160 is a negative 102. This one's not even cubic. Well, I certainly hope it's quartic because that's the last option we have for regression. Negative 6 minus 18 is negative 24. Negative 30 minus negative 6, also negative 24. This is looking good. Negative 54 minus negative 30. Negative 78 minus negative 54. Okay. Negative 102 minus negative 78. Good. So that one checks out. Our differences were the same once we got to the fourth level. So this is a quartic function. And again, we know it's quartic, so we don't have to do any work with plotting points or anything like that to try and look at end behavior. We know. Oops, got some of my little arithmetic checks there. So I'm gonna go back to the stat menu. I'm gonna edit the stats, and I'm just gonna type over what I had originally. So before we started with x equaling negative 1, now we start with 1, and we're just going to count our way up to 9. All right, then the y column, our list 2, we go from 0 to 6 to 2 to 6, 12, negative 10, then negative 114, negative 378, and negative 904. And again, just a quick check that I didn't forget a digit or something along the way. I'd really hate to be off just because I typed something in the wrong way. Okay, it's looking pretty good. So let's go stat, calculate, and I know this is a quartic regression, so this will be option 7. Hit enter. These should be set by default for most calculators, so if we scroll all the way down to calculate, it should be good to go. All right, there we go, and you can see we've got A, B, C, D, E. E is going to be our constant at the very end. And you can see that R squared value. Again, this because we got the finite differences to work out, because we had nice evenly spaced data, this is a perfect match. They won't always be the case. Okay, so let's go ahead and jot down that polynomial. All right, so from our regression, we got the function y equals, or y hat equals, negative 1, that's x to the 4th, plus 13, x to the 3rd, minus 58, x to the 2nd, plus 104x, minus 58. All right, so there we have it. It's pretty time intensive, but it's pretty cool that we can take a list of a few points and come up with a function that those points are representing. That's pretty neat. Okay, bring that calculator away. Example 3. The table shows the ages of cats and their corresponding ages in human years. All right, so if the age of a cat is 2 years old, then in terms of the cat, that would be a 24-year-old in cat years. Okay, so the age of the cat's equivalent in human years. Find a polynomial function for the data for the first 8 years, and then use this a model to estimate a cat that is 3 years old. All right, now if we take a look at our x values, I go from 1 to 2 to 4 to 6 to 7 to 8. They're not equally spaced. We're missing some values, so we can't use finite differences. I do not know if this is a cubic or a quartic or a quadratic or a linear even. All right, I do notice that we're increasing by somewhat routine increments on the y-axis. So let's go ahead and take a look. I'm going to pull the calculator back up again. We're going to take a look at what graphing the points, just to kind of take a look at the function and see what we're working with. All right, so I'm going to clear out that. I'm going to go back to the stat menu, edit. To clear out a big list like what we just entered from our last example, if I hit the up arrow key, you can see it selects list 2. Do not dare hit delete. We're going to hit clear and then enter. That'll wipe out the entire list for you. Clear and then enter. That way these stay named as list 1, list 2. If you hit delete, it'll screw everything up. It'll get rid of that list entirely, and your calculator won't know where to look for y values. So we want to be careful with that. So our age of the cat, x, 1, 2, 4, 6, 7, and 8. And its equivalent in human years, 15, 24, 32, 40, 44, and 48. You know, it's interesting. After doing a couple examples like this, I actually looked into how they make these calculations. How do they determine how many cat years are equal to one human year? And it's kind of interesting. They look at stages of development of the cat. Like, think of when a human first starts walking is usually around 1 year old. But like a baby kitten will start walking in a matter of weeks. And so they use that kind of relationship to determine this data. It's kind of neat. All right, so we have our data points, but we couldn't use finite differences. I don't know what type of regression to use. So what I'm going to have to do is a stat plot. It's up here above the y equals. So I'm going to actually hit y equals first. Oh, and you can see there's a function already entered. I want to clear that out, because I don't want anything else graphing except for these data points. So we're going to hit second y equals to open up the stat plot. And you can see plot 1 is set to use list 1, list 2 as our x and our y. But right now it's turned off. So I'm going to hit enter and then turn plot 1 on. And it's by default, it's going to use points to plot. And it's using our x's and y's from the correct lists. All right, so it's got those points plotted already, but I'm not going to be able to see them all. Just because if you look at the numbers in that table over there, they go way beyond what a typical screen shows. So there's a nice feature, and I mentioned this earlier in the notes, zoom, and then if we go down, I think it's option 9, is zoom stat. That will automatically fit the window to include all of our data points. So I'm going to go ahead and hit enter there. All right. So if you look at this, it does look fairly linear. However, notice how it wiggles a little bit. I think that a cubic function would probably be a better estimator than a best fit line. It's just a hunch. So let's go ahead and see what a best fit line gives us in terms of like an R squared value. So if I go stat, calculate, and I choose linear regression, and I calculate that, you can see it's a 0.9845, so a pretty good positive correlation as far as R squared value goes. It's a pretty good best fit line, so 0.985. Let's take a look if I do stat calc and do cubic regression. There you can see I'm at 0.997. So the cubic function actually fits that data set much, much better than a linear regression would. So this is definitely the regression method that we want. And again, if we go back to our graph, you can see the reason we're choosing cubic is see how it falls to the left and rises to the right. A quadratic doesn't do that. A quartic doesn't do that. Those are the ones where the ends either both fall or both rise. We're seeing something that is progressing from the bottom left to the upper right. So we knew it had to be an odd degree polynomial, a linear or a cubic. All right, so if I quit and go back to our screen, oh, it looks like I'll have to run that again. Cubic regression was 6. We'll calculate it one more time. Let's see what we got here. So our regression equation tells us the cubic function 0.096, if I round to three decimal places, x to the third, minus 1.526 x squared, plus 11.425 x, plus 5.479. And again, that's rounded, but that's a very good polynomial regression equation for this data set. So we're going to estimate the age of a cat that is 3 years old. You can see that value is missing from our data set. It goes right in there. So if I were to guess, I would expect to see an answer that's between 24 and 32, maybe something like 28-ish. Okay, so into the calculator, I'm going to pull that back up. I should have left it up in the first place. I'm just going to type in 0.096 times 3 to the third minus 1.526 times 3 to the second. Then we got plus 11.425 times 3, just my x value there, and plus 5.479. Enter. And we get 28.6.2. That actually fits kind of what we expected to see in the graph as well. Okay, so 28.612 human years. Now, one of the things to keep in mind here is that these functions, they do allow us to make predictions for the future, but notice they make this claim that's for the first 8 years of a cat's life. Why do you think that this function can't be trusted beyond that? So for a fun little task, I used to have a cat named Jerry who lived to be, we estimate, we don't know how old he actually was, but he's estimated to be around 18 years old. So let's just see what an 18-year-old cat would be in human years, just for kicks. All right. So I'm going to go back. I'm just going to hit the up arrow key and grab what I had before. And everywhere I'd put an input of 3, I'm just going to swap that out with an 18. There. And here. Two hundred and seventy-six point five seven seven years old. So you can see that really doesn't make sense considering the average human lifespan is somewhere between 70 and 80 years. You'd expect an average cat lifespan to, even a really long-lived cat like that wouldn't be much beyond, you know, maybe 110 or something like that. So the function does lose its accuracy as you move further away from the data. That's important to realize. All right, and that is the end of this lesson. So hopefully, again, we saw a really good look at how polynomial functions can approximate a data set to help us find values that may or may not be needed in between those data points. Thanks for watching, and I hope you walk away from this video a little bit feeling like you know a little bit more about math and a little bit more of the usefulness of it.